Is it me to visit some of you? What is it that makes you and you that glow? Dark is it not with love in you? See the steady, but in you will live.
As a singer-songwriter, if you're lucky enough to record your own songs, it is probably the ideal thing because it's a creating process that starts with an idea in your head, and then many months or moons later, there is the finished product with backing, recording, recorded in a proper studio that you can share with people. I have found that the best way to do this is to book a very good studio, to get a very good producer or engineer. In my case, it's my friend Peter Pilsen, and we have worked together since 86 up to today, and we are best friends and musical friends as well. I have worked with a lot of top musicians, like the late Jethro Butta on guitar. It was his first session in his studio when we booked him. I've worked with Moritz Lotz, the maestro guitarist. It was his first session in the studio as well. I've worked with the late Kevin Kruger, the drummer, and who could also sing very, very well. I have worked with Richie Cannata of the Billy Joel Band, who played saxophone on my fourth album, and Snuffy Walden, who played guitar on the fourth album. He was from the Stevie Wonder Band. A lot of the work was done with the producer, Chris Christinger, who had very, very good ears, and an arranger called Dan Hill, the late Dan Hill, who could play a multitude of instruments. Dan could sit down and there would be noise around him and maybe even music playing. And I've only heard this twice. In the one person was Lulu van der Walt, and the other one was Dan Hill, where there's other music playing, but they're writing this music down that we are going to do in the studio, which is a total different piece of music. I could never understand the lateral thinking behind that because I cannot do that. Dan Hill was quite a character. He wore high heel boots to make him look a bit longer, and he was a wonderful man. Sitting at the back of his studio and then standing up with his platforms. And when Lori Karach started recording, I took her to Dan and Chris. And then at the end of her debut album, she gave Dan a book as a present to say thank you. And it was a book on garden gnomes. And Chris and I looked at each other, and here was this man with his problem with his height, and she gave him that book, but it was all great fun at the end. Dan Hill, when I tried to do a comeback album with Sonja Herold, the Ritzel in the Ritbos in 98, I wanted Dan, who was a multi-instrumentalist. He could play a lot of instruments. And I asked him to do this clarinet solo on one of the songs, and he said, sorry, I can't do it. I said, why, Dan? And he said, no, because I've got a gig tonight. And I said, but what's the gig got to do with this? He said, no, but on Thursdays I have my hair done, because on Thursday evenings I have a three-piece gig at a jazz club, and the earphones are going to up my hair, which we all thought was very funny, and so we did the gig on the Friday. All's well that ends well. And people like Jethro Butta had a very good sense of humor in the studio. After the sessions, now we're talking about 2-3 o'clock in the morning, and we're just all sitting talking rubbish in the studio. And then Jethro would all of a sudden look up and said, is that the sound of ink I hear drying on a chick, Anton? Which I thought was very, very zen. In our South African setup, we are a multicultural society. And as a songwriter or a singer-songwriter, I've always felt very strongly about influences, culture contamination. So when we did Dancer, I was lucky enough to work with Lucky Dube, who was a wonderful, wonderful man, very clean. He didn't drink or smoke. In fact, he only drank water in the studio, and he forbade me to smoke cigarettes in my own studio. But what a wonderful character. And then I did, when I was little, I heard my mother had a Sunday school set up on the farm in the garage on Sundays for black people. And I heard them singing. And with that sound in my head, I always wanted to do a multicultural album, which I did when I did Bushrock. And I used the late Isaac Mtsali, who played drums on Paul Simon's Graceland, and the late Jito Baloyi, who was the bassist for Tananas, and a man called Kenneth Mataba on guitar. He was a left-handed guitar player. And it was wonderful. It was really a wonderful experience because I discovered that Buru music, which translates to farming music, which is a traditional South African form of Afrikaans music, it was very, very close to Marabi, which is a traditional black music. When one strips the music down to its roots, it is very, very close to each other. So up to that point, I was used to studio session musicians that were like very funky with funny chords that they wanted to introduce into the music instead of staying with the basics. And there's nothing wrong with that, but that was not exactly what I always wanted. And with Bushrock, Isaac Mtsali asked me to come and sit on the floor with him and to play my guitar so that I can hook onto your roots, my brother. And that's when I knew we've got this. We've got this. We are going to hear these songs through the same pair of ears. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience of culture contamination. And music is the biggest peacemaker there is. Okay, I hope that helps.